Fanta grape soda. I'm a fan. I'm definitely a fan. It says this was made in Mexico. Son of a gun, I always thought Fanta was made in the United States. I looked on the ingredients, and this has real sugar in it. No high fructose corn syrup at all, just real sugar. Strange days indeed when we think real sugar is the good stuff, but it really is. It's kind of warm and a little bit humid today and breezy. Yeah, well, what can you do? And I thought, why am I going to do story time in the voodoo garden? I could be outside. This is what I live for. So what better place to do story time than in the garden? And I just happen to have a book. It's wonderful. I'm going to actually get really start enjoying this story time outside instead of inside. I don't mind being inside, but I definitely prefer being outside. Now, oh, by the way, gather around. Hi. Welcome, everybody. Gather around, kids, boys, girls, aunts, uncles, dogs, cats, the occasional bird. It's story time from the Big Book of Ray. Last we left off, I had just moved in with my real dad, my father, and we were in somewhat of a cabin out in an apple orchard. So this is where we're going to pick up. Rise and shine! The following morning greeted us with a shiver and sunshine filtered through the one window of the cabin. Only one window. And that was kind of odd for me, seeing just one window in a complete structure. Just one. Almost like a little jail cell. But it was cozy. Tending the fire was no joke, as I was instructed by my dad. A stirring of the ashes in the firebox revealed just a few mildly smoldering embers from the night's fire. Blow gently and place small sticks there and there. With a little patience, the embers ignited the wood, and our cabin warmed quickly with the aroma of applewood smoke. And those of you who have a fireplace, if you ever want to get a good smell, get applewood, even applewood chips for smoking stuff. For some reason, applewood puts out the most beautiful smell. Hickory and stuff, they all have their smells. Applewood, I don't know. I think I have a little place in my heart for it because of my dad. Breakfast was simple. Coffee for Dad, fried eggs and toast cooked on a wood stove with an ice-cold glass of milk for Ray. After the dishes were cleaned, we bundled up to head outside into the orchard. And that's one of the things about my dad. He may have been a hobbit, lived in a little shack out in an apple orchard, not been exactly what I had pictured him to be, but you know what? My dad was a clean person. He may not have had a lot, but he took pride in what little he had, and I got to give that to him too. So we, dishes, no such thing as dirty dishes in our house, no such thing as a dirty floor, clothes lying all over the place. The place was nice. It wasn't spick and span, but it was neat, and that's one of the things that he impressed upon me. Row upon row of mature trees laden with round red apples stood before me. All was perfectly silent except the muted sounds of tiny droplets of rain from the dew-covered trees. As we walked, my dad educated me of the different types of apples, their uses, times of harvest, and distinct flavors. This orchard is wine sap apples. They're used to make juice. He then reached up and selected an apple. I remember this. I remember this as if it were yesterday. He then demonstrated for me his method of drinking of apple juice without using tools. This is something I didn't know. With firm, measured action, he wrapped the fruit against a ladder, rotated the fruit just a little, and repeated the process until all sides received a firm wrap against the ladder. Once finished, he then handed it to me. Bite into it and gently suck the juice out. To my absolute amazement, I was quickly rewarded with a mouthful of cold, fresh, sweet yet slightly tart apple juice. This was pure magic. I had never heard of this trick, and yet, with my own eyes and taste buds, the proof was right there. Instant fresh juice from an apple. Now, we take apple juice for granted. It's so cheap, you can buy it in the store, really, really inexpensive. It's all over the place. But to get it fresh from an apple, fresh off of a tree, in early morning when it's cold and the smell of trees and dampness is in the air, the morning dew, there's nothing, nothing in this world that compares to that. I had heard of this trick, and yet with my own eyes and taste buds, the proof was right there. Dad offered a final instruction to only do this once in a while, because unless you eat the juiced apple afterwards, this would be waste, and wasting apples was not right. In the following days, my dad taught me how to properly pick apples. And that's one of the things he impressed upon me as well, is of course the love for nature. That's, I think, where I got a lot of this. That seed inside of me, I think I inherited that from my dad, because he loved nature every bit as much as I do. He didn't have a garden, but he loved going on walks, showing me all the little things growing around the rivers and in the apple orchard. He just came alive. That was his place. He was born to live in an apple orchard, the little garden gnome that he was. But he didn't like waste. Even though that was a cute little trick, we ate the apple afterwards, you know, for a snack. So he didn't throw anything away. Grasp the apple firmly. This is for picking the apple. Grasp the apple firmly with your pointer finger, level with the top of the apple stem, and quickly tilt and tug the apple. This removes the fruit along with its stem, the little stem on the top of the apple, while not tugging off the leaves or breaking small branches. A lot of us don't know that. You just think, yank, and you yank an apple off. That's not how you're supposed to do it. You're supposed to put your finger where the little stem of the apple meets the spur of the tree, and then just so, and it usually pops it right off of there. Respect of the tree was the highest importance in his teachings. Ladder usage also was taught, with specific warning of the result of improper placement. To me, he seemed a little bit obsessed with safety. How hard could it be to pick apples? Just pick up the ladder and start picking, right? I spent my first few days picking alongside my father, filling my tummy with fresh, delicious, free apples as I worked. Free, delicious food grown in the sunshine in paradise. And I ate a lot of apples, and I gotta say, I didn't put this in the book, but if you eat a lot of apples, that's a lot of fiber. And older folks know what a lot of fiber does to your system. Try eating a lot of prunes or a lot of raisins. So yeah, I learned about fiber after eating about, I don't know, a half a dozen apples a day, every single day. In my enthusiasm, I somewhat discarded his safety warnings. While at the top of my ladder, happily filling my sack with apples, a sensation of weightlessness came upon me as I suddenly realized I was falling backwards. Not long afterwards, as I regained my consciousness, yes, I did lose consciousness, my dad's face above me was the image of concern, with a hint of irritation, just to make it interesting, I guess. How do you feel, Ray? Try sitting up. Do you hurt anywhere? From his explanation, I and my ladder fell like a tree in the woods, and the sound I made was a rather muffled thud, thanks to the soft grass under the trees. Aside from a bit of confusion and bruised pride, I felt pretty good for a kid who just fallen out of a tree. A half hour of drinking apples and resting, and I was up and picking again. The lesson of the ladder placement stuck fresh in my mind with new and lasting importance. Lesson learned. Okay, Fanta break. I don't drink grape soda that often, only in summer. It's not a winter thing for me. I just love the taste of grape soda. Orange soda too, but generally Orange Crush is my favorite. Fanta is the second favorite, but you can't find Orange Crush in single cans in the stores anymore. Okay, now that you know that, back to our story. Watching the migrant workers deftly harvest fruit at a swift pace and their seeming lack of appreciation for the privilege of picking apples for me was pure joy. And no doubt the other workers were a bit puzzled at my pleasure of working such a monotonous, menial task. And these were Mexicans. They would come up from Mexico, and these were migrant workers. They would come up from Mexico for the apple harvest. They would pick apples, and then after apple harvest, they would do the pruning of the trees in later fall, early winter, and then they would get deported on purpose. And I watched this. This isn't just a myth or a rumor. I watched this. They would call immigration, get themselves deported. It's a free ride back to the Mexican border, and they would be sent back into Mexico. And however you feel about illegal aliens, the thing is that they came up here to pick apples, and you didn't see white people in there picking apples. All you saw is Mexicans, because white people didn't want to do it. It didn't pay much at all. Excuse me. They would take that money home, give it to their families, the wives and kids, and then they would come back up the next spring, and then they would start all over again. So that was their job. That's what they did. So anyway, I'm not talking about the politics of anything. I'm just telling you the reality of the situation. They were very nice people. Initially, my arms and back muscles became quite sore from the long periods of repetitive movements. As time passed, the pain subsided and was replaced with vigor, endurance, and an overall feeling of health and peace. Peace is the word. Picking apples all day with my dad while breathing fresh air. What a life. The owner of the orchard paid $8 per bin of apples picked. A bin measured approximately 4 feet by 4 feet and 3 feet tall. Now, to give you an idea of that, I know that the measurements speak for themselves. My raised bed down in Lower Unctown, those are not quite 4 feet, all right? But they are almost 4 feet. If you take them up another foot or so, or 2 feet, that's how much it would be. You gotta pick that many apples, one at a time, and put them in there. And the bag holds about maybe 5 pounds of apples. So you go up the tree, fill up the bag, go down, empty the bag, go up and do it again. And then once you have a whole bin of those, $8. At the end of the day, he gives you a ticket. And then you redeem the ticket at the office and they pay you $8 in cash. So that's how we did it. My dad could fill 3 bins per day. I filled 2. $40 for a full day of work. By today's standard, will you quit doing that? By today's standards, this is nothing. This was 1974 and 1975, somewhere around there. It was enough to feed us, and I was helping. I had a sense of purpose and was contributing, and that's something that I'd never felt before. I never really felt like I was part of the family. And with my dad, I was part of his family. It was our family, and we were both doing what we could to bring in money to support ourselves. So it was a family endeavor. So I was contributing. This was a very good feeling. Although I slept on the concrete floor with just a few blankets and no mattress, I slept better than I could imagine. The fire crackled happily in the evening as we sat and talked and laughed. We played card games as Dad drank a glass or two of his burgundy wine. Dad didn't own a television, just a tiny portable radio that received a couple staticky channels due to the mountain interference. This is back in the day of just AM radio. We didn't need television. Life was good and clean and fresh, just as I had imagined it could be. As you may have already realized, this paradise was not destined to last. No paradise is destined to last forever, and neither was this one. Apple picking season is very temporary. Soon the crop was picked and shipped to the processing factories. The bare trees began losing their leaves as autumn progressed. Work abruptly came to a halt. As the skies turned from blue to gray, the temperatures dropped to an uncomfortable chill. Winter was creeping in, and Dad seemed to have lost most of his cheerful manner. No longer picking apples, I was set with the task of finding wood and keeping the fire alive in the wood stove. This was imperative. If the heat went out, the water pipes in the cabin would freeze because we had no basement, no crawl space or anything. It was a concrete slab floor, and the pipes ran along the sides on the floor. If the heat went out, the water pipes in the cabin would freeze, resulting in Ray better keep that fire going. Dad took the ride with the migrant workers to the northern orchards for pruning season. This is work performed at a time once the sap of the trees ceases flowing. Workers prune off certain branches of the tree to shape and promote best growth. And that's what I show you here in these. My dad showed me how to do it, but I wasn't skilled enough to do it professionally. So, no, I didn't go with them. Anyway, they pruned off the branches. As I was unskilled in this, I could not join Dad to help earn money. Pruning paid far less than picking, and work was not as available locally. Dad would arrive home late in the evening, tired and sometimes smelling of wine or beer. He would sit by himself at the table while I slept. His mood, it became dark and broody. As the season brought the shroud of persistent frost and snow, he progressed into a lifeless and silent mood. It's almost as if the season dictated how he was. You know, when the green went away and the blue skies and the fresh air and the vigor of summer went away, so did the vigor of my father. The all-important slug of soda. When I would attempt to talk or joke around with him, it often resulted in a grumble or forced conversation. In time, the effort seemed pointless, so I stopped trying. Thanksgiving arrived quickly, and without the usual fanfare of relatives, decorations, or preparations, as I had known from life with my mother. Funny how that is, you know. I think back to my time with my mother back then. And as a kid, I thought back to that, and I thought, no, I don't want to go back there. I want to live with my father. But I forget about some of the good times, you know, Thanksgiving with my relatives and the turkey and Christmas and things like that. Things that you might take for granted, you find out later on that they were good times. And I do look back on those times. I remember them fondly. But then back then, I didn't. As the holiday approached, it became apparent there would be no Thanksgiving. No Thanksgiving? None of Mom's stuffing? No room temperature cranberry sauce or mashed potatoes with extra gravy? The refrigerator contained no holiday goodness, nothing. Nothing more than a half-empty bottle of Burgundy, bread, and bologna. The tiny radio played crackling music as I contemplated this gray, new life and periodically poked the fire. These days repeated themselves without change until the afternoon before Thanksgiving, when a car motor could be heard pulling into the driveway. My dad went outside to greet the visitors. Yelling, laughing, and car doors sounded as another vehicle pulled up. Suddenly, the door opened and hippies! Hippies crowded into our home. Bright colored vests, long hair, and big joyous smiles everywhere I looked. Dad, smiling for the first time in quite a while, he pointed at me and exclaimed, this is my boy Ray. Handshakes and hugs and handshakes with hugs all came at me rapid fire from the friendliest strangers I had ever met as the room filled with the aroma of cigarettes, wood smoke, wine, and beer, and a new aroma I could not quite identify. It was a somewhat pungent odor I could not quite understand as it wafted around the small room from a hand-rolled cigarette. I'm being very subtle about this. A very large man dropped a bundled package into the sink, and as it was unwrapped, he exclaimed, "Thanksgiving is here!" And that's how he stood it, very magnanimously. "Thanksgiving is here!" In the sink was a full, meaty hind haunch of deer, a deer leg. The man's wife or girlfriend and a couple other girls laughingly shoved him aside and began carving the hunk of meat, tossing chunks of meat into the large stew pot with spices from their satchels and then some water. She began to work her magic as I watched in amazement and a bit of admiration. She may be a strange-looking creature, but she laughed and wielded that knife like a magic wand. A bit later, the tiny cabin filled with the fragrance of good things cooking in the giant pot on our wood stove. The hippie women tossed in peppercorns, cloves of garlic, and a host of vegetables as her pot simmered. Music played and people laughed and joked. By the way, my dad, he played guitar. And a couple of the guys, they brought guitars and they would all just start playing guitar. And they were singing songs, little rock and roll songs and stuff. Actual hippies. And I'd never seen hippies before in real life. So this is the first time I'd ever seen them. They were odd. They were colorful, like peacocks, you know? The first time I ever saw hippies. And I liked them. Music played and people laughed and joked. My father's face was alive and filled with happiness as everyone shared in wine and one other tidbit of holiday cheer. The handmade cigarettes were being passed from person to person to share. The faint, odd smell of earlier was now strong as the small room filled with its smoke. This cigarette was not offered to me. I did not smoke, of course. As time passed, though, I noticed a feeling of slight confusion, but yet calmness, and a bit of giddiness overcame me. The smoke from their odd cigarettes filled the room and my lungs. I was stoned. And regardless of what your political correctness thoughts or your thoughts on drugs are at the day, they were smoking marijuana, and this was in the days of hippies. Now, I don't condone it. I don't speak bad about it. I'm just saying what was, okay? So this is just what happened, and this was, like I said, a whole different era where everybody smoked, and half the people smoked pot. Anyway, yes, at the ripe old age of 13 or 14, I was stoned. There is no nice or politically correct way to say it. As time and space and music drifted along in my mind, a bowl was handed to me with what smelled like heaven, or something quite close to it. A small spoon of broth woke my taste buds with the gamey flavor of venison, but tempered with earthly tones and layers of garlic and plenty of pepper. Nothing had prepared me for this culinary masterpiece. A second bowl was all that was needed to fill my empty stomach and place me in a comfortable, warm state of euphoria. Wrapped in my blanket on the floor, I drifted off to sleep in my home, filled with the sounds of laughter, happy conversation, and the crackle of the wood stove. This was Thanksgiving, and it was something worth being thankful for. Oh, another slug. Now, by the way, that stew, of course, I was stoned. But then again, the flavor of the stew was good regardless of how I was mentally. It was a darn delicious stew because we had leftovers. And the next day, of course, we ate those leftovers, and the day after that, because we didn't have anything else to eat. And it was just as good the next day as it was that first day. And I made this recipe not too long ago on my program in my kitchen, and I call it Hippie Stew. I didn't have deer, I only had beef, but I had lean beef to use for it. And I recreated it to the best that my mind and my taste buds and my memory could bring back to me. And I did a pretty darn good imitation of hippie beef stew. The trick is lots of black pepper, fresh ground black pepper. You may think, too much pepper isn't so good. In some things, it's what makes it or breaks it. And with that hippie beef stew, that and the giant cloves of garlic, not even really cut up, just bashed and thrown in there. The large chunks of everything, it was absolutely perfection. And it was better than any Thanksgiving I'd ever have with turkey or gravy. Thanksgiving was truly an oasis in an increasingly dismal time. Tree pruning season ended and no work could be found. The cabin was rent-free, but food and electricity were costs that remained regardless of income or lack of income. School was something I chose to avoid. Picking apples with my dad was where I chose to be, and luckily for me, my dad allowed this. In retrospect, though, this was not the decision of a father at all. No father should allow a child to make these life decisions for themselves. Oh, I gotta turn it off and turn it back on so that I don't screw it up like last time. Hold on a second. And we're back. I just got a few more pages to go. Not long into December, we moved. As many times as my mother moved us throughout the years, you would think I'd be accustomed to this process. And yet this time, even though my home was nothing more than a tiny one-room structure, I felt comfortable here. And I was not happy at all to pack up and leave it behind. My dad was unimpressed with my protests, and off we went. I mentioned earlier he drove an older Mustang. Remember the Mustang? Well, this vehicle was borrowed from a friend. Dad owned no vehicle. December in Eniat, Washington, with winter in full force, the two of us walked, me carrying my suitcase while Dad carried his suitcase and a backpack, and his guitar, by the way, along the snowy roads we walked until cars on rare occasion would pass. Now, this wasn't an interstate. These were small roads, so there wasn't a lot of traffic in the wintertime out there. Along the snowy roads we walked until cars on rare occasion would pass. Out his thumb would go to attempt to hitch a ride. My best guess is that I was a good portion of the reason we achieved rides. A scruffy man can be ignored, but a short, skinny kid seems to tug at sympathy strings. Regardless of how it was achieved, we managed to acquire short rides to get us a little further down the road until we reached our destination. And thank you, Wind, for turning the page for me. Our destination, Brewster, Washington. Actually, we passed by Brewster and ended up a bit farther down the road. A winding, rarely traveled road which took us a few miles north of Brewster to a grouping of what seemed like abandoned shacks next to an apple orchard, kind of like the ones we came from. Snow was a bit deep and no footprints or tire marks disturbed the snow around three of the four buildings. One shack, though, was lit with lights inside, giving a bit of a warm, welcoming glow on this icy winter's night. This was not our shack. Ours was 20 feet away, dark and cold inside, but when the lights were turned on, they revealed a dirty, uninviting hovel furnished with a cushionless, filthy couch, small wooden table with two small chairs, a small fridge, sink, and apartment-sized stove. Graffiti! Yes, graffiti adorned the dingy walls. What a nice, vulgar touch of class. Aside from the obvious homeless poverty appeal of our new domicile, my attention immediately was drawn to two doors. Our other cabin didn't have but one door, just to the bathroom. This one had two doors, actually three. Each door revealed a tiny empty room. Each room contained a single bed frame with a thin prison-style mattress. Bedrooms! I had my own bedroom. And that seems like such a small thing for folks, and they take it for granted. When you sleep on a concrete floor for months with nothing but a blanket, and you see a bedroom that's all your own, you get excited. We had definitely moved on up, and I liked it immediately. We spent the first couple hours tinkering with a vintage gas space heater, coaxing it back to life, and then slept on the floor in front of it to stay warm. It would have been nice to have food, but sleep was a welcome thing at this point. Ah, looks like it's going to rain again today. I'll just keep on reading. You don't mind, do you? Get an umbrella. I'll read in the rain. The morning light revealed the truly, truly filthy nature of the shack. No worries, though. The space heater had taken the edge off, and Dad had a pot of coffee on the stove. The aroma of freshly brewed coffee gave our new home a slight feel of comfort. And it was comfortable. I know it sounds like a pigsty with all the graffiti and the dirtiness and stuff, but the thing is that living in his cabin had taught me that it isn't possessions. And also his attitude wasn't possessions. Possessions are not what make you happy. It's love and family connection that made me happy. My connection to my father and his connection to me, that's what made me happy. So it doesn't matter where we were. As long as I was with him, I was happy. So it didn't bother me. We just took what we had, pulled ourselves up by our own bootstraps, and we just made the best of what we had. So that's just what we did. Not really a fan of the bitter taste of coffee. I tried some for the first time because it was warm, and the alternative was a glass of ice-cold water. We had nothing else in that house. We sipped our coffee as Dad readied himself to head out and hitch a ride into town. His plan was to find work at the apple processing plant in town, in Brewster. My task was to borrow a rag from the neighbor and do my best to clean the home. Not much can be cleaned with plain water and a rag, but I did my best. With a borrowed broom, the floors were swept as well. I sipped cold coffee throughout the day as I cleaned. My stomach was not in the best of condition from lack of food combined with the caffeine throughout the day. I was humming right along, I was. Long after the sun had set, a vehicle pulled up to deposit my dad, carrying two paper bags. Once inside the home, the unmistakable, enticing aroma of hamburgers filled my nose. Cold, of course, but yet more than a welcome first meal in well over 24 hours. Eggs, bacon, flour, sugar, and other assorted necessities were unpacked and put in their respective places. One bottle of Burgundy took its place on the table. Dad sipped wine while I made my way to bed. The following morning, Dad again left early. He had acquired a job at the apple plant and received a small advance on his first paycheck in order to purchase our food the day before. While Dad worked, I was left at home alone. Most days, I listened to our tiny radio, which received much better reception than at our former home. When boredom became overwhelming, I journeyed out to explore the orchard. Not much to see except empty branches and more empty branches, but this was good exercise and broke up the boredom. And the snow, by the way, was deep, so I was out there with no snowshoes. I had to put on like two or three pairs of pants, and I think I only had four pairs of pants. And everything I wore, basically, everything I owned, I was wearing, and I trudged through the snow, but I didn't mind. It was adventure time, and I didn't have to go to school. So, you know, that was a bonus for me. A couple weeks later, Dad informed me I was to go with him into town to enroll in school. I had hoped this time would not come, but I have to admit, the dread wasn't as much as I assumed it would be. The mind-numbing boredom and loneliness of being alone every single day in a small shack was definitely becoming increasingly difficult to endure. School, although not a thing I relished, would at least break up the monotony of being cooped up staring at four dingy walls in our shack. School was, of course, school. The first months of living with my father did not include school. I was a valuable resource, helping him pick apples to earn money to support us, and the orchard owners usually looked the other way when it came to who harvested their crops. They did. They didn't care if it was kids, illegal aliens, they had to get their crop in. And when nobody would apply for the job, it's either hire the illegal aliens and have them use their kids in there, or you don't get your apples harvested. That's their thing. That's not mine. I'm just saying how it was. Many illegal migrant workers and children worked the orchards. With only factory work available, there were strict guidelines, and those laws definitely prohibited me from working with my dad. Enrollment in school was his solution. I think not so much for the benefit of learning, but I think more so to keep me occupied. The new kid in a very small town attracts stares, whispers, and some giggles, especially when that kid comes dressed in worn clothes, better suited to picking apples, along with rather long hair at this point. I hadn't had a haircut in like 6 months, so yeah, I was pretty shaggy. I was self-conscious of how I appeared to the other kids, but there is not much one can do about the condition of clothes. My reaction to the sudden attention was to shy away and keep to myself. I was pretty good at that from living with my other family. Not make eye contact and definitely not speak or raise my hand. Having missed the first half of the school year, I was very lost in the curriculum. Most of my school time was spent trying to stay under the radar of teachers. Being a low-income family, a special form needed to be filled out and presented to the school to allow me to receive free lunches. This is a service that they used to do. I don't know if they still do it. But if you were poor, you would fill out a form and your folks would enter their income and all this other stuff, sign it, and the child would get a free school lunch so that they wouldn't have to go hungry. In the lunch line, we would present our lunch ticket to be hole punched for each day's meal. They would punch a hole for each day of the week. Those with paid weekly tickets presented white cards. The few of us with free lunch cards would present pink cards. More than a few times, I would catch the card punch person's eye as they viewed my ticket. Depending on the person, it would be a look of indifference or distaste, but mostly sympathy. The sympathy hurts the most. Luckily, my long bangs pretty much kept eye contact to a minimum. Yeah, I did. I had hair down to almost my nose, and I would always comb it down, so I wouldn't have to look at anybody, and they wouldn't have to look at me. I'd like to pause for a moment to speak with you, if that's okay. By now, I imagine you're thinking, holy cow, Ray, I thought this was going to be a gardening book. I didn't think I was going to be reading sad stories from your life. And yeah, I guess a lot of people might have thought that it was going to be a gardening book, but it is a gardening book. It's about a gardener and his path through life and what actually took him to be where he is today. So all of these things that I tell you, whether they're good, whether they're bad, whether they're interesting or not so interesting, these are all the puzzle pieces and all the bricks on the path that led me to where I am, and they all come to play in my modern day life. So things that you see here are going to connect, and you're going to see why I tell you what I tell you, so that you can know me a little bit better and understand why I do the things that I do. Okay, so it's not that I'm trying to get sympathy or trying to tell you all the bad things. This is just how my life progressed. I had not a whole lot of control over it, but this is how I dealt with the situations that were dealt to me. So your point is good, and I respect that. This book is a chronicle of my path in life, like I just told you. Many have asked how I grew to be the person I am today. My early path in life was set by events beyond my control. Yet my character was forged by the manner in which I faced these challenges and in many ways eventually found a positive outcome to a negative experience. These events and stories all culminate in who I currently am. You will find towards the end of this journal the beautiful picture of all of these events paint in the current tapestry of my life. Lastly, these stories do have everything to do with gardening as well as how I view and practice gardening. I promise, if you continue to read, you'll begin to understand, or continue to listen to me read, you'll begin to understand and actually enjoy the journey with me. So with this in mind, I hope you continue with me. Okay, enough of this. Back to my life. And we'll get back to my life in next week's reading of the book. And in next week's reading, I'm going to introduce you to another housemate. And his name was Shazam. And I'm not going to tell you anything about it. You're going to have to tune in next week on the reading of the book. And that pretty much concludes today's reading from the Big Book Array. I hope you enjoyed yourself. And if you have any questions concerning, oh, look at me changing glasses. I have glasses for every occasion. Reading glasses, seeing glasses, computer glasses. But yeah, it was actually a lot of fun sitting out here in the garden enjoying the weather and reading to you. The light's a lot better. I feel a lot better reading. And it doesn't smell like chicken butt. It stinks in there. You raise chickens in your house and you tell me it doesn't stink. There's a lot of chickens in there. So next week we're going to go into the next chapter of the book, and it gets a little interesting and kind of fun in a way too. And it'll tell you a little bit about why I like a certain food. You're going to have to tune in for that. Okay, I got to finish my soda, head on inside, edit this, get it uploaded, and I will see you next week for the reading of the book, and I will see you at the end of this week for the regular gardening program here on the Practice 55712 channel. Thanks everybody for joining me. Have a great day. My day just got better.